Hi, this is Dr. Claire, and this is the first of two lectures on plant diversity. In this lecture, we're going to be talking about the seedless plants, all right? So if you look at the evolution of land plants did diverge from a sister group of green algae. They probably started as an aquatic plant, and the earliest groups to diverge off of that common ancestor were the non-vascular plants, or the bryophytes. These are plants that did not have an extensive vascular system, and they include the liverworts, the mosses, and the hornworts. Then you have, after that, you have the vascular plants, which are depicted in pink on this graphic here. Those vascular plants all had more well-established, diversified vascular systems that allow them to transport water. And there are some plants in there that are seedless. So in this particular lecture, we will be talking about the lycophytes and the ferns and horsetails, which are also called pterophytes. And then the seed plants we will hold off on until the next lecture. Okay. So if you look at the prevalence of these plants over time, early on, the seed plants had not yet emerged. They didn't emerge until around 300 million years ago, and the first land plants probably emerged a bit before that, maybe 450, 500 million years ago. And so at first you just had those seedless vascular plants that were pretty common, particularly in the period between 350 and 300 million years ago. And then you had the emergence of the seed plants. Conifers and cycads were the first dominant seed plants. And then when the angiosperms emerged approximately 200-ish million years ago, they quickly radiated, and most of the plants that we have on the planet now are actually angiosperms. although some of these other groups are still present. So we're going to be looking at some of these other groups first. All right, so let's start with the bryophytes. The bryophytes are the non-vascular plants. They tend to be relatively simple, relatively small, and very dependent on water. They do have some adaptations to land. They have a waxy cuticle that's protecting them from dehydration. They've got some little rhizomes, not true roots, but little rhizomes that are going to connect them to the soil and allow them to uptake water from the soil. But they do have some pretty primitive requirements. They do require a moist environment, and they can't reproduce without the presence of water. So they need to have water for the sperm to swim from the male gametophyte to the female gametophyte. And hopefully you remember that from our reproduction lecture. And remember also with the bryophytes, when you're looking at the green plant that is a green plant, that is, you're looking at the gametophyte, not the sporophyte like you are in all of the other plants. So it's the gametophyte that is large, the sporophyte is small and dependent upon the gametophyte, and they're really quite different from the other plants. In most ecosystems, the bryophytes aren't super important. They're not doing very much of the photosynthesizing, but there's one exception to that, and that is the peat bog. A peat bog is the dominant plant in a peat bog is actually the sphagnum moss, and sphagnum moss is a kind of a cool moss. It's super absorbent. They actually used to use it for diapers before the advent of modern diapers. You just would dry out the sphagnum moss and then pack it into your kids' pants, and it would absorb any urine that was produced. So that's kind of cool. But that sphagnum moss in a peat bog is the major photosynthesizer, and it photosynthesizes a lot of light, and it also makes a very acidic environment. So in a peat bog, as the plants die, other plants kind of grow on top of them, and you get these layers and layers and layers of dead plants, and the acidic environment that's produced by the sphagnum moss prevents those plants from decomposing. So you can get this really thick layer of organic material, and it's a really good carbon sink. It's a great way to get carbon out of the atmosphere and trapped and into another thing. And peat, that dead plant material, has actually been used as a fuel for heat and for cooking in some cultures for thousands of years, because there's a lot of trapped energy in that dead plant material. So now we're going to move on into the vascular plants. The earliest vascular plant was probably a very simple plant without many leaves or without any true roots. But we do have fossils of these very early vascular plants, and they did show some other adaptations to living on land. They were the first to have the stomata with the guard cells, so they were able to regulate gas exchange a little better than the bryophytes were. They also had the more advanced vascular tissue, so we have fossilized xylem tissue. And they started to get root-like structures, not true roots, but more root-like structures than were present in the bryophytes. A true root has vascular tissue. So these are not true roots because they do not contain vascular tissue as of yet. So if you look at the seedless vascular plants, or the vascular plants in general, let's start by talking about the vascular plants in general. They're sometimes referred to as the tracheophytes. Trachea refers to that those tube-like systems. And within the vascular plants, there's three major groups. You've got your lycophytes, those are your club mosses. You've got your pterophytes, those are your ferns and horsetails. And then you've got your seed plants. And again, we're going to talk about seed plants in the next lecture. So let's talk a little bit more about the lycophytes and the pterophytes. Okay, so lycophytes are actually relatively common. They've got a worldwide distribution. They're particularly abundant in the tropics, but I've seen them in Canada, so they're definitely present in other places as well. They look a lot like a moss, but they do have a vascular system, so we know they're not a moss. One thing that's kind of cool about the lycophytes is that they do produce these sporangia. Now remember, now that we're out of the bryophytes, the green thing that you're looking at is now the sporophyte. Sporophyte makes spores. So they produce these sporangia, and they'll produce clouds of spores from these sporangia. That's what these things are right here. And my ecology professor, when I was an undergrad, showed me that the spores from the sporangia are actually quite flammable. So you can knock them and create a little cloud of spores, and if you have a lighter, it'll go up in flames. It's kind of cool. They're a little bit explosive. They don't have any true roots. Again, true roots have vascular tissue, so the lycophytes have root-like structures, but they don't have vascular tissue within them. And you're looking at a dominant sporophyte when you look at the plant. Lycophytes used to be one of the dominant plants on the planet, and there used to be giant lycophytes that were tree-sized. And we still have fossilized lycophytes that we've found. These are some fossilized lycophyte trunks. There are no giant lycophytes left now, but many of these giant lycophytes were actually the source of coal. So when these trees fell and their trunks were buried in the soil, they became the coal that we now dig up and use today. A lot of that coal came from these ancient lycophyte forests, which is kind of cool. The Wisk Ferns. We are now into the pterophytes, out of the lycophytes and into the pterophytes. Wisk Ferns are a kind of a weird group. They don't have any true leaves or roots. They're just kind of little photosynthetic sticks. They are mostly found in the tropics, and some Wisk Fern gametophytes have some vascular tissue. They're actually the only gametophyte known to have vascular tissue, which is kind of cool. All right. Horsetails. Horsetails you may have seen growing along a creek in Colorado. They kind of look like a bottle brush almost. They've got a central stem that's jointed, and then they've got these whorls of photosynthetic stems that come off the side. And they have underground branching stems called rhizomes, and they actually do have true roots coming off of those rhizomes. They've also been called the scouring rush because historically they were used as a cleaning product. They were used like a scrubby sponge for cleaning your pots or dishes. You could scrub with them because of the silica in the cell walls. They made a really rough surface to get food off of things. So they're kind of a cool plant. The ferns you're probably more familiar with. They're also a pterophyte. They're the most abundant of the seedless vascular plants. There's about 11,000 species of fern, everywhere from these tiny little ferns that you might see growing in the forest that are only, you know, a few inches tall, to tree ferns, which can be 30 or 40 feet tall. So there's a lot of different, a lot of diversity. They do grow from fiddleheads, so you often see them uncurling as they grow. And fiddleheads are a delicacy. They're quite tasty. They're kind of like asparagus. So if you get an opportunity to try fiddlehead, try it sometime. All right, that's it for the seedless vascular plants. So check in for the second lecture on plant diversity on seed plants.